So next we have the keynote, and our keynote speaker, let's put our hands together for Ramanathan Guha. Guha is the creator of widely used web standards such as RSS, RDF, and schema.org. He's also responsible for products such as Google Custom Search. Until last year, he was Google Fellow and Vice President in Research at Google. He has a PhD in Computer Science from Stanford University and a Mechanical Engineering degree from IIT Chennai. Guha, let's welcome on stage. Ramanathan Guha.
It's kind of ironic. Long time ago, when I was a student at Stanford with Ashish, switching from a very respectable field, mechanical engineering, to this thing, AI. My dad was really, really worried. How on earth are you going to find a job? Does anybody know this? Is this thing going to just go away? And it's so ironic, like 30 years later, it's hot thing now. It just kind of looks, feels very, very, very subtle. I'm actually going to try to avoid use of the word AI and machine learning in most of my talk. And try and ground it into what's really happening. You will not see anything like the videos that you saw earlier of robots coming over. So here's general outline of the talk. I'm going to try and ground it into why is there all this hoopla around data science and machine learning, and I'm going to use a different term, call it empirical modeling. Then I'm going to make a case that it's not so much about the algorithm, it's about the data. Tell you a little bit about this work that's been going on around schema.org, introduce this concept called data commons that's going on at the NSF and a few other places. And then stop with just looking back at, you know, lessons. One of the advantages of having so much gray hair is that I've seen a lot of this stuff play out. What are the lessons that one can learn from the evolution of the web and how we might apply them? So, at the end of the day, it's really, really about models. Modeling is central to everything from engineering to finance, forecasting, and things like that. And without a model, you know, it's basically essentially called building anything. And at the end of the day, what is a model? It's a set of variables and a set of constraints that capture the behavior of the system, and we want to optimize for this, or, you know, find a set of binaries for variables that satisfy the constraints, and so on. There was engineering before models. There was no actual model for fluid dynamics that was used in Kitty Hawk. But the time you get to, you know, the Airbus 380, you do need models. There was no model for St. Peter's, but by the time you get this monstrosity in Dubai, you need a model. So what are models? I'm going to classify models into two broad categories. One are what I call analytic models. And these are there's basic equations that capture continuum mechanics and heat transfer and fluid. And each of these equations is interesting because it's not just a set of correlations between variables. They capture underlying causal phenomena. Right? There's, you know, every one of these things tells you something about what's happening in nature and tries to explain it and more. Can you go back to it? And if you look at a course in engineering, especially the real engineering sciences like mechanical engineering and electrical engineering, you have, you know, thermodynamics basically revolves around 3 or 4 equations. Strength of materials revolves around a small number of equations, and you put students through a semester long, or sometimes 2 or 3 semester long exercise, so that they understand these equations very, very deeply. Computing came into the picture in the 60s, and interestingly, the slide rule, which was created, was because you couldn't do these, it was getting too onerous to do all these calculations by hand. And you do need these kind of finite element models. So I read that the Boeing 787's wingspan can flex 26 feet. Next time you're sitting in one of those things, think of that. 2017, the plane would break apart. And how do you compute that, right? And you need detailed models. And for that, what we did was we brought in finite element methods, but it was still manually built models using the same small number of equations that we saw in the earlier slide. There are limits to these analytic models. There's lots of phenomena around us which involve people. How do you predict the behavior of this train? How do you predict what's going to happen in a place like this? Or at this Stanford, you have these kids who are supposedly very well educated, who dress up like trees and run around. How do you predict what happens there? We don't have the Maxwell's equations, the basic equations for social phenomena, behavioral phenomena, economic phenomena, any complex things which involve a very large number of anything which involves humans in a very significant fashion. That's how water. About 15 years ago, we saw the rise of what I call empirical models. And the interesting thing about empirical models is there are no causal equations underlying. Simply take lots of data and fit the curve. The important thing is lots of data and a lot of compute power. And these things have been massively successful in the last 10 years. Not surprisingly, they started off with better ecosystems because that's where the data was and that's where biggest concentrations of compute power are. The most well-known, it wasn't called, the machine learning part of it was not emphasized then, the most well-known of these things was Google Spellcheck. There's a long history of how they tried various spell correction tools and this and that, it just wouldn't get it right. You don't find the different spellings of Britney. What is the right spelling of Britney Spears? Well, it isn't there in your dictionary. But if you use data, the web is a very large corpus of data, and the different spellings that people use, and a very simple model of the kind of typos that might occur, right? You could actually build a truly amazing spell correction system. And most of us, I mean, I use more often than not, you know, when I need to figure out a spelling, either I just type in something and expect it to tell me what the right spelling is, or go to Google, and just imagine this amazing cluster of machines being used as a spell correction tool. But that's what we've come to right now. Another huge application was web search and advertising. The entire machinery which tells Google how likely you are to click on a particular ad is all machine learning, and it's surprising to me. It's an amazing system. Newsfeed, and more recently, we've seen lots of huge things in perception and vision and things like that. Face recognition, which was kind of a pipe thing 20 years ago, is just now taken for granted by any Photoshop app. But, you know, so much more can be done. I remember sitting in some meeting and saying, you know, wow, okay, fine. We figured out that, you know, when somebody asks for chips, it is queries from the Bay Area, California, and especially the Bay Area, it's better to show them kale chips, and if it's from, you know, somewhere else, it's better to show them potato chips. Fantastic, we have used tens of thousands of machines to sell the right kind of chips. And do better than that, right? And so, there's a hope that we can actually solve some of the world's more pressing, more real problems. There's a phrase which is, calculus turned out to be an incredibly powerful tool for physics. It's not clear whether classical physics would have developed anywhere as far as it developed without the power of calculus. I'm arguing that empirical modeling is a similar tool for really complex systems. Now, one of the really surprising things, if you look at the kind of models that are being built today, that people are talking about it in minutes, and you go back to the algorithms that are being used, many of the core algorithms that are being used were developed the convolution neural networks and LSTMs and all of these things were there in the late 90s. It's not as though somebody came around with a breakthrough algorithm. These algorithms have been around for a long time. So what is it? Obviously, it's a lot of computing power. But more than that, it's the data set stupid. And that's why the progress is coming from the people with the larger data sets. Google and Facebook and Amazon and all of these people. Data sets and research directions. And I'm going to just go over a few of these examples. The first of these cases was something which was done somewhere in one of these here by the late Jim Gray, where he realized that the traditional way of doing astronomy research was that you spent some time at an observatory. And that had all kinds of implications. He realized that there's whatever happened 25 years ago in a very faraway place does not have that much commercial value. And he convinced there's only seven or eight primary sources of data from the satellite radio telescope and infrared telescope and so on. And with help from the NSF and NASA, he convinced these people to give him feeds of the data. He got it all together and created what's called the Sky Survey. It's the Digital Sky Survey. Utterly, completely changed the way astronomy research is done. That was actually one of the early arguments of what was to come. Another example is MNIST, where NSF and others collected a data set, not large, 60,000, but for its time it was large, of handwriting samples. And for handwriting recognition, they restricted themselves to the numbers to keep it simple, but without MNIST, that progress would not have happened. And a lot of the interest that you see now around image recognition, computers can recognize this and recognize that, and so on and so forth, comes from this corpus called ImageNet, which is run out of Stanford, which is a large corpus of labeled images. So the takeaway, there's one takeaway from all this, is the most important thing that you should do is create large, interesting data sets. There are some common things about a lot of these data sets. They are not ran, they have noise, but the noise is very low. They're fairly homogeneous. They're very large. There's a couple of one other story. I was talking to somebody who actually works for Lufthansa. And it turns out that Lufthansa makes a ton of money by doing maintenance for aircraft from other companies. And the fascinating thing is its biggest competitor in this business in Europe is Boeing. So Lufthansa is competing with Boeing on maintaining Boeing planes. You think, why would they even have a chance? It turns out that Lufthansa has been in that business for longer and has more data about how Boeing planes go wrong and what to do compared to Boeing. Right? That is the power of data. And if there's one thing that you do about your business, it's like, what is the core data that captures the essence of the business? And make sure you have that, you don't ever throw it away. And you keep bringing it back and bringing it back. And as Sarvesh mentioned, the interesting thing is that as you apply machine learning to it, you learn more about what's missing. One of the things we learned at Google was, it's fantastic to have algorithmic improvements and so on and so forth, but nothing ever beats a new signal, a new kind of data. Those always gave the biggest difference. So there's, I broadly distinguish between three kinds of data sets. One is these closed, carefully curated data sets, where a single entity is doing all the collection and the curation and everything else. Sloan Sky Survey is one of them. I mentioned NNIST, most user data, and user data is by necessity of that sort, but most of these other things can't get very large simply because of the constraints of one entity. There's another type which has come into vogue over the last 5 or 7 years, where you have lots of contributors, but one entity decides what goes in. Wikidata is the best example of this, ImageNet, and a few other, and there's lots of these efforts to collect this kind of data. And then there's the old, the wild open. Anybody can produce anything, anybody can go collect and pay to a certain sense. The web is the best example of this kind of stuff. And and I'm going to give a few examples. This is my favorite simply because it's in my team. I'm going to talk a little bit about one particular project that I was involved in and an effort called schema.org, which is an attempt to get, you know, what are some of the issues that happen when you get a large number of people to produce data, to publish data, and then collect it together and basically use a coherent. So one of the interesting projects that's been going on for a while in many of the tech companies is, in addition to having a corpus of documents, one of the things that powers a lot of these things, if you look at Knowledge Graph, Google's Knowledge Graph, and Bing has an important version of it, there are these things powering CDN, Alexa, and so on and so forth, is you need a database of structured things. People, places, organizations. You need to know what the business hours are, and your classical tech search doesn't. One of the most challenging of these kinds of things is images. Because you have a country, and another, the opposite of the example, you don't have a new country, you don't have 10 new countries every day, so it's economically feasible to have a set of people simply type it in. Events, tens of thousands, if not millions of images. Each of them, most of them have very, very local in terms of there's five conventions or four conventions going on in the city right now. I wish I had known that. I wouldn't have got stuck in traffic. I won't go for the joke. Events have a problem, which is there's just too many of them. There's concerts, there's soccer games, and yoga classes, and what's absolutely essential for one person is totally uninteresting for the other billion and a half of them. So how do you make a list of all these events? Business hours. And second thing you can do events, you can do business hours, you can do this, you can do that. And this started off with an effort to, traffic prediction, right? I mean, you go to Google, you go to this, they can give you an estimate of how much they tell you what the traffic situation is now. But if you want to decide what time to leave tomorrow morning, you can go ask them, but if they don't know that there is a big convention, there is a big football game, there is a big whatever, they can't tell you that traffic is going to be much worse or much less worse than normal. And in order to do a good job, you need a classical, you need to be out here. And just leads us to this general theme of work that I've been involved with for the last, I don't know, 20 years or so. And it is around the idea of built by many words, structured data on the web, semantic web, linked open data, etc. But let me step back and try and give you a picture of what this whole project is about. So the original web was designed for human beings. And pretty shortly after the whole web, this web thing started, sometime in 1993, 1994, Rob McCool decided it needs to be a way of taking data that is in a database and creating and pouring it into a web page. So he created this thing that we've all seen somewhere or the other now called CGI Bin. It's interesting, he was an undergrad, nobody wrote it, so I think such a thing should not be done. Shortly after that, sometime starting 96, 97, there was this idea that, look, you have all the structured data out there and my app wants to consume it. And there have been efforts, including, the most well-known first effort of this sort was Jungly, where they said, yeah, just scrape it. And that was amazing, I'm sure. And the point there is that once you have the structured data that is behind all these different databases, there's a huge number of other kinds of applications that can be powered. And what does that mean at a high level? And these are two, Venn diagrams always fall back to Chuck Norris. This is a page about Lawrence Tomatoes about Chuck Norris. This is a page in IMDb about Chuck Norris. They both have common things, that he's an actor. He was born in Bryan, Oklahoma. He was born in the, on such and such date. It would be nice if the page, in addition to all the text, included some kind of markup that was easy to extract, which gave us this data. Two very interesting points about this, which is it, from 96-97 onwards, everybody agreed that the model should be a graph, a direct labeled graph data model, not a relational data model. And the other interesting thing was you need to have all these guys use a common vocabulary. If they don't use a common vocabulary, you're going to have, it's going to be impossible to reconcile all these different things. So there's lots of different problems to be solved. As I mentioned, the data model, what is the syntax, what's the vocabulary, what are the identifiers for the objects, ton of interesting technical questions. And then there was this other question, like, why should the author give us the data? And being good computer scientists, everybody just plunged right in. And it was like, seven, 8 years of God knows how many standards. There was things from, you know, back in the day when we had these, I was at Netscape and we had the holy wars of then between Netscape and Microsoft. Microsoft figures in a lot of these holy wars. And then there was just so many standards. And you know, it was just, and it was fascinating that at every point that it didn't succeed, people felt it hasn't succeeded because our standard, our technical tools, don't have enough bells and whistles. If only we add this feature, if only we add that other feature, everybody will realize, oh my God, I got to do this. The problem was there simply wasn't compelling application. There wasn't a good reason why IMDb or Rotten Tomatoes or somebody else should publish their structured data. Sometime in 2011, we launched this thing called schema.org, and it was Google, Yahoo, Microsoft, and then Yandex decided, okay, fine, we got to figure out the right ecosystem in which for everybody to start publishing their data, because it became obvious that using simply writing as a differentiation was not going to, was going to start. And what schema.org did was it said, okay, fine, here are four syntaxes you can use, but here is the core common vocabulary. This is how you talk about business hours, this is how you would talk about address, this is how you would talk about A and B and C and everything else. Yeah, what, now it's what you call it. We also provided an extension mechanism, which I found out a little bit later. The other thing we did was to say that we're going to make it really, really, really easy for webmasters to publish this stuff. So what does it actually look like? So this is a page about a particular event. I was giving this talk at DARPA a year and a half ago, so I picked something from there. It's in Fairfax, Virginia, and it's just like, there's a million things, not much. 100,000 or 50,000 things every day going on like this, or every week going on like this, right? This is what this page looks like. I think it's an event provider or something like that. If you look under the page, that's the HTML there. There is the structure data underneath that. It's basically saying that they're offering these tickets, the price of the ticket is zero, this is when the ticket sale ends, and so on. It's very easy for a crawler to go pick out this data and have a structured representation and all that. Okay. So why would users do this? It turns out that webmasters will do lots of unnatural things to get more traffic. You take this data, and if you're talking about, for example, if you go to the query Zahn Mountain View, and you basically add there's a little bit of this, you know, this is the price range, and these many reviews for this hotel, and these many reviews are there, these many stars for the hotel, and these many reviews are there, and things like this. The click-through rate of that search result goes up. The user is attracted to it. They say they understand whether it's good or not. Therefore, if, you know, site A is doing it, site B is going to be doing it. That was one huge class of things. The next thing that happened was that it obviously became important for email is another source of information, right? So my favorite example, and having worked at Google, of course, food is the most important thing. You go to OpenTable and make a reservation, and you get this confirmation email. You look at this view source, the HTML email. You'll find that it has schema.org information, which tells you all the information about what time is your reservation, where it is, blah, blah, blah. The fascinating thing is that it goes to your phone, into Gmail, it is on your phone, Android or whatever, picks it up, tells the server that, hey, this appointment is there, so that consults map, so that when it is time for you to leave for your food, the dining thing, it tells you it's time for you to leave. Isn't that amazing? Involving tens of thousands of machines all over the place in order to make sure you get here at the normal time. This thing was a fascinating exercise because there's all kinds of issues that crop up when you're trying to deploy this to. It's perfectly fine to do this as a little thing, a lab exercise or a little thing. When it's running for 300 million people, there are edge cases. And every once in a while, an edge case happens to hit a CEO. and the kinds of edge cases that come up are kind of fascinating because some restaurants in New York need you to be there half an hour before to be seated. The person misses the dinner, it's not good. And there's the events which are happening, which delay five. It's quite fascinating. So the numbers, I mean, all this stuff makes sense only if it's actually working and being adopted. It's actually in use by over 20 million sites right now. And after the initial search sites, one of the interesting things that's happening with Siri and Alexa and all these things is that there is a much greater need for structured data because this data has to be formatted either as voice or in cars or whatever right on the device. So Siri is now using it, I think Alexa is using it, Google Personal Assistant is using it, and so despite being at this level, in the last 12 months it's grown by over 20%. Roughly 50% of the US EU e-commerce mails have it. The core term itself, core vocabulary is about 2,000 terms. And there's another interesting distinction that is beginning to happen, which is if you take something like Realist, there's two kinds of sites. Sites that make their money, like Zillow and so on, by you going to their website. And there's other sites, other businesses, which are simply want the data to be like the MLS service. Very few people go to the MLS service website, and the MLS service doesn't show you ads and make money that way. They just want the data to be really widely spread. If you're a restaurant, you don't care that people come to your website. You just want to make sure everybody has your business hours. So you're going now to the second layer of these sites, where they're all just publishing their data because they want the best version of their data to be out there. Every open house listing is out there so that you can easily find it. And that thing is taking off. And one of the reasons this thing is happening is because all the platforms like Drupal and all of these guys decided to just natively support this. We also introduced an extension mechanism, and the real estate people were the first to pick it, one of them to pick it up. There's a group, the FIGO group, where you guys probably know much more about it than I do. They're doing an extension, schema.org extension, so that a lot of the some of the banks at least are starting to publish this stuff. And that becomes important if you want to pick it up in a very high frequency. These are all the sites which are publishing it. It's pretty much all the major sites. It just gives you an idea that if you want to, it's a very, there's things that you're going to do as individual companies that you don't share. There are things that are too large for you to do as individual companies. And over there, it makes sense, and we've seen this in industry after industry, but it makes sense to come together and establish an industry platform for data. Not these guys didn't pay me to say it, and I didn't pay it. It's like groups who are not actually in your business, but who are support businesses. It's a wonderful, neutral thing to create this data platform to be able to, so that the data which is not non-competitive proprietary, non-proprietary data should have a platform for sharing. So it turns out there is.
So there is a lot of data, as I mentioned, all these 300 sites, data.gov puts out an enormous amount of data, lots of private data sets. Why aren't we, inside these big web companies, we're seeing huge amounts of, we're beginning to see breakthroughs. I was talking to somebody who was telling me about the kinds of things the insurance industry is trying to do using machine learning and data. But why are we seeing more of those? Then my basic conjecture is that it's just too hard to use. As with the web, before the web, we had FTP sites. We had hundreds of thousands of FTP sites. And we had millions and millions of files there. We had millions or billions of Word documents. But this whole collection of that did not equal a single web. So if you take a step back, these kind of machine learning systems, which is a black art, if you talk to the Stuart Russell at Berkeley, he has this derogatory term for it, called these called layer twiddling. Like you can't tweak this parameter here, tweak this parameter, it seems to work. Why is it working? Not really sure, but look, it works. Right? There's a lot of black art in there. It's an enormous amount of data mining nightmare. And nobody, it's not a cool, sexy thing to say, I spent 80% of my time making sure the data formats were aligned and cleaning the data. It's much cooler to talk about the fancy algorithms, but a lot of that stuff goes in there. These systems are incredibly complex, but the complexity is going down dramatically with the introduction of things like TensorFlow, where these things mostly work. The current model for using data sets is forage for data, track down all the assumptions because none of the data sets will actually clearly list all the assumptions that have been made, clean it up, compile them, and then you go figure out the storage and figure out this and figure out that. And I've been spending a bunch of my time in the university environment. It's actually quite horrible. A big part, if I'm a grad student and I want to experiment in the data set, which is a reasonable size, at least a few terabytes, I have to spend 3 months taking care of the logistics of getting the data, finding a place to store it. Maybe there's an NSF grant for writing this thrown in, which makes the whole thing a 9-month process. Hello world, it's just too hard. If you want to try something, you need to take, a good lesson to learn is with the more technically sophisticated hedge funds. They have enormous teams for better platforms so that a new model can be tried out in a matter of a few hours. And then ultimate is, of course, places like Google and Facebook, where they try and bring down the time that is required to test if a model will work down to under an hour. And so if you take it from 3 months, 6 months to under an hour, the range of things that you can experiment with dramatically goes up, and you are much more likely to find the thing that works. So one of the projects that I'm involved with, and it's also being, in fact, there's a big meeting at NIH next week, funded by the NSF. This whole ecosystem, this has to change. What we need is what we call a data talk. Rather than go from, I'm going to download the data and run my stuff on it, what you want to do is log into a Cloud Shell, SSH, cd/data, and whatever data is accessible to you is available there. And you can have, it's not, it shouldn't be, it's just a single, there's lines over here which are not coming across, so sorry for that.
it's not just a single, just like the web is not on a single proprietary service, it's across multiple places. Similarly over here, it should be possible for everybody from Microsoft, Google, Amazon to have copies of this stuff. And different places will have different subsets and so on and so forth. That's fine. But the whole cycle, if you want to try out something, you go there, some of the data is public, some of the data is private, some of the data may be for free, some of the data maybe you might have to pay for, but you can try a new thing in a matter of hours or actually days. So the core idea is that you bring the code to the data, not the other way around. And you should be able to try do something new in under 30 minutes. Once you have that, if I have a new tool, if I have a new interesting thing, I put it close to the data. Right? It makes it much easier for an ecosystem. Somebody comes along and does a derivative of this data, some derivative problem. They create it, leave it there. And so what you have is an ecosystem, and the way the web developed. The web would not have developed but for a suite of tools. In the early days, it was, it started off with HCSA, servers, then you had Perl, and Perl was a big thing, and then you have PHP, Python, and all of these times, and now you have a suite of machine learning tools, Scikit and Jensen and so on. There's this ecosystem that's being built up. We don't have a corresponding ecosystem of programming tools. We don't have a corresponding ecosystem of data. And that is something that a bunch of researchers are actively working towards creating and thinking, what would it take to create that? I'm going to give you one example of a project that we're working on, and it has to do with the energy ecosystem. The energy grid that is as of say 10 years ago, you have a smallish number of providers, which is a big power plant. You had a grid, and the power plants ran pretty much independent of, it didn't matter what was happening outside. The power plant could produce a certain amount of power, and it did. Nuclear is the most extreme example where it took a long time to start it up, and it kept at that level. Now, there's a bunch of things that are happening, which is the weather fluctuations are getting more extreme, so the power consumption patterns are varying quite a lot. Most of the grid operators, their personal life, they love renewables, in their professional life, they hate renewables. It's just awful. I mean, power does not, if you produce too much of it, you can't just dump it. It's energy, bad things will happen. You have to find a way of putting it in the right place. So Germany, for example, overproduces power from 10 to 15%, because overproduction is much better than underproduction. What do they do with it? Well, they decided they would sell it to Poland. And Poland said, you really don't have much of a choice. You have to give it to us at a steep discount. Okay. Poland finally realized, actually, you're going to pay us to take it. And that's what happens now. Lots of places in Texas, which is actually one of the biggest producers of wind power, the cost of electricity goes negative at parts of the day. Right? So wind, solar, all these things have wild fluctuations. Next one. On top of that, you have, this project is going on at Stanford. Places like Stanford are now commissioning, Stanford has its own power plant. It turns out the power plant is not here, it's in Southern California. Well, it needs to decide what to do with the power that is going to be produced tomorrow. And so, every electron looks like the next electron. So, they actually sell this power to somebody and then they buy it. And they have to decide, there's a market called CAISO, which is where you can buy a day ahead, you can buy an hour ahead, you can also offer to sell. It's basically it's a futures market, right? And so Stanford has to decide. Stanford spends over $10 million a year on power, even after this thing came off. Has to decide how much is my consumption tomorrow going to be? And this is an incredibly complicated issue, because especially for a Stanford. If it turns out it's spring break, power consumption is going to go down. If it turns out it's, you know, people moving in week, it's going to spike. If it's exam week, it's going to have a different pattern, etc., etc., etc. And you have thousands of company entities like Stanford who are joining us. So, so we started looking at Stanford called the Energy Data Commons. It started off with, in Stanford it has all these wonderful propositions. Thanks to something called Prop 39, we can get the historical power consumption of all government buildings, including high schools and such. Stanford buildings, and we thought, okay, fine, we put all this data together so that all the energy researchers who are trying to predict grid stability, etc., would be able to share this. Word got around, and then the folks at Berkeley said, can we have access to the data? And in a moment of inspiration, they said, sure, if you bring similar data from Berkeley, Illinois, CMU, everybody wants it now that the data set is large enough to be interesting. Everybody thinks the data is a true commons, it's a co-op of some sort. It's still getting started, and it includes lots and lots of data, PMQ data, which is smart meter data, weather, geo, things like tree covers make a lot of difference to the event census. You want to be able to do things like predict. Some of these entities involved want to do things like what's going to be the power consumption of Lafayette. You know, you think in years from now, well, depends a lot on the demographics of that, right? A whole bunch of these kinds of things. So right now we have these four kind of universities, more will likely come in, which is, universities are not great places for developing software, so thanks. So how do we build one of these things? There's also a project that's starting off at business school that's way more ambitious, which is basically to look at a lot of this. The economy is run in large part through economic indicators, right? You have the unemployment data, you have the consumer confidence index, and a few of these things. If you look at the way this data is collected, it's really small samples. The data varies a lot, the data quality varies a lot, it's lagging indicators, blah, blah, blah. Can you do a much better job by actively treating the web as some kind of reflection of all human activity? It turns out you can actually do a bunch of these things, and there's some early results, maybe later on. So we're trying to build a substrate of a data graph about cities, census, weather, business, and common stuff. And then there's very data specific to very particular domains. There's one particular thing, technical point I'll leave, just briefly mentioned, and then go on to the lessons on the web. One of the most, the hardest challenges in pulling something off together like this is illustrated by this picture. So there's a musician called Tori Amos, again, aging myself. But here, there's data about her and things, entities associated with her from a bunch of different places. So this thing says she was born in Newton, North Carolina, which is located in North Carolina, and Newton is a city whose temperature is such and so on and so forth, right? Any one of these subgraphs comes from one place. What you want to be able to do is to take, and so it comes from the geo data, music brains, Wikidata, NOAA, and so on and so forth. What you want to be able to do is to take these pieces from different places and give you an integrated view so that the person doing the machine learning algorithm doesn't need to worry about where, doesn't need to worry about the different sources of things like that. And here it's basically a problem of, in large part, a problem of names. And if you're interested in geeking out about this, I can talk to you about what different kinds of techniques that are being used to do all this resolution. So stepping back, my theory is that we're in what I call the 1993 moment. You know, we all know what happened. Can we make something similar happen for data? And what are the lessons that they can learn from the law, right? from the past. I don't think the lessons are at the level of they should use HTTP two slash as opposed to one slash or whatever. There's kind of a little bit more general than that. And then he goes, let me touch on a couple of lessons that I have taken away from all this. There were online services before the web. There was Prodigy, MSN was going to come online, AOL was the biggest of them. There were million, and there was Word, they were in Word, WordStar, WordPerfect, all of these things were there. So it wasn't some new, amazing technology. TCP IP was there. And in 93, a number of players wanted to sort of own the net. AOL, the leader, was giving away 15 million accounts. IBM decided it needed to be part of this new thing. It invested heavily in Prodigy. Microsoft was the most aggressive at that time. It was scary. It was planning on spending $2 million on the MSN network, and MSN was going to be bundled with Windows 95. And these guys actually had a pretty good list of features. They had security, they had commerce, they had publishing tools, they had a whole bunch of these things. Bill Gates, I remember, wrote this book which came out early 95, where he used the term information superhighway. And there was not even the word internet, web, nothing occurred in that book. It was supposed to be, the focus was, there was another focus which was, you know, Silicon Graphics was going down this path of on-demand TV channels. There were going to be 1,000 channels. Oh my God, how are we going to ever cope with that? Interactive TV, etc. Really fancy technology. Can you go back to the slides? One of the interesting TV shows that I saw, I remember in September, October of 94, was Nathan Myhrvold, who was the CEO of Microsoft, being interviewed on MSNBC or Friday, which is what the thing was. And the interviewer, who was amazingly technical for 1994, said, so what about this web thing? And Nathan went through and gave 10 reasons why this web thing would not work. It didn't have security. MSN had security. It didn't have identity built into it. MSN had identity. It didn't have shopping and e-commerce built into it. MSN had it built into it. And it didn't have an authoring tool. Text edit is not an authoring tool. It went on. And every one of these things was true. What was on the web? You had researchers and enthusiasts. And the hot thing in 94, on the other side, 94, 95, early 95, was some student in Bristol University, I think, in England, put a picture of, you know, of a thing which we didn't have video then. We were taking a picture of a coffee. They had a coffee tank. Right? Just look at what happened. You had true, David and Goliath scenario. And by end of 94, 95, December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day, 1995, Bill Gates gave his famous talk where he said, "You're dumping MSN. It's the web or nothing." Right? Just about a year, what happened? It was just there's two reasons, and I think that's those are the two lessons to be taken away from. And the core is that as much investment as MSN had could put in, it could not compete with, I'm saying thousands here, but it was actually tens of thousands of contributors who are pooling their resources to make something work. And there's two reasons for this, and go into that. Can you go into that? Open systems. AOL, MSN, all of these guys, if you wanted to get your content there, you had to go do a deal with. And if your community was too small to be of business interest to MSN, you were left out. The publisher is the closest. There had no such barriers to entry. I had this other experience once where 98 or 99, I was at Netscape. We were trying to build this create a portal for on Netscape's homepage, which could be like Yahoo. You could have your own modules. And, it's my Yahoo, my Netscape. Yahoo had those deaf people and so on and so forth. And so they went and did deals with 20 different publishers, and you had 20 modules you could choose from. Netscape was dying. We didn't have any such thing. So as an act of desperation, we created this thing called RSS, which was just open. Anybody could publish a format, and you could pick whichever one you want. And our goal was like maybe in 3-4 years, if it's still alive, there would be like 2,000 RSS channels. About 3-4 weeks after we launched this thing, I got an email from somebody saying, hey, did you know the Mormon Church just published its RSS channel? Well, what? And it turns out, I tracked them down, and they had a very simple thing. It's just like, look, we don't expect our people to make our thing the homepage, their homepage, but we can tell them that if you're using Netscape, then add our channel. It was simple. We were catering to way in the tail over there, something which is simply not possible with a closed system like MSN. Everybody should be able to play. It doesn't matter if what your community is, what your this is, if there's data out there. If you have interesting data, you should be able to contribute to this. The second part was that, text edit was a tool. It was trivial to put up a simple website. And once you did that, technology developed, it was possible to do complex things. As opposed to the barrier, which is doing a pilot for television. It's not trivial to take the first step. You can do something, but somebody is there who's going to say yes or no. Or building one of these giant systems, the bar to hit it, the hello world is much too hard in today's machine learning. You've got to break the hello world so that it's basically as simple as trying out a few things on your Excel spreadsheet. And does it work or not? If it works, I'm going to go put more money into it, otherwise I can back off. That made it so easy to attract so many people that said, let me put up a little website for my project, for my company, for my whatever, right? And that got so many people. I'll end with one story. It's a story of Aldous Manutius. So, actually, I'm curious, how many people here have heard of Aldous? Gutenberg was the printing press. He was a goldsmith. Before Gutenberg, there were, I've heard different reports, anywhere from 30 to 50 to a couple hundred books in all of Europe. These books were, they are mostly the Bible, they were all handwritten. And they were incredibly valuable, so they were chained. And you kind of left it open at a certain page, and so on. So when the printing press came, Gutenberg basically made it possible to produce more things of the same sort. The number of books increased, but they were pretty much the same. And then about 30, 40 years later, there was this saddle maker called Aldous. And Aldous had this, at that time, what seemed to be an absolutely crazy goal, which was to be able to put a book in a saddle bag. Which meant all kinds of interesting things. Which meant that you could close the book. And you had to be able to reopen it. Which meant that you should be able to just hand the book to somebody. So you don't go to the book came to you. Right? You got page numbers. You got table of contents. You got all these things. And one of the biggest first users of Aldous' technology, or breakthrough, if you will, was the translated Bible, which was distributed, Martin Luther translated it and distributed it. And without that, it's entirely possible that the Reformation would not have taken place. You look back at when TV came, what did people do? People would come, and like on radio, they would read scripts. It took about 20, 30 years to, for this, maybe shorter, maybe less, for the thing to catch. When telephone came, the thing was, why would anybody be crazy enough to put a telephone in their dining room? I mean, anybody can call you from anywhere, that how rude that is. It takes time for the new technology, for the new, for these things to find their groove, to find their niche. And we're just now beginning the story with data. So, with that,